Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Today I want to talk about all the different kinds of viral genomes that exist and how they work in a general way. And then towards the end, how we can manipulate them and a little bit on genetics. Okay, so this is called genomes and genetics. It's mostly genomes. In the 1950s, now you remember from our first discussion that viruses were discovered around the turn of the 20th century, late 1800s, 1900s. It took a long time before virologists figured out what the viral genome was like. And that happened in the 1950s when it was determined that the nucleic acid of the virus is the genetic code. So people thought for many years that it might be the protein, and there was a lot of debate, but finally in the 1950s they sorted it out. And there were two important experiments that led to this conclusion. The one on the left, called the Hershey-Chase experiment with bacteriophage T4. And if you have taken biology, you should have heard about this. It's a very famous experiment. We'll talk about it in a moment. And that was for viruses with the DNA genome. So they figured out that inside this phage particle, it was known that there was DNA in there already. And that DNA is the genetic material. On the right is a picture of our tobacco mosaic virus, the first virus discovered. And experiments done by Frankel Conrat showed that the RNA of this virus is the genetic information. So TMV was different because its genome was RNA as opposed to DNA. And what this virologist did was to separate the protein and the RNA, purify each one, and show that the RNA by itself was infectious. You could put that in a plant and it would give rise to new viruses. So it was the genetic material. So let's look at this Hershey-Chase experiment. This is a really famous one done by Al Hershey here and Martha Chase. They were at Cold Spring Harbor. And it's an experiment that involves a blender. It's the famous kitchen blender experiment. And if you go to Cold Spring Harbor, they actually have a museum where they have one of Hershey's old blenders. It's a metal blender. And the experiment here was to figure out what part of the phage was the genetic information, the nucleic acid or the protein. So what Hershey-Chase did was to make two preparations of phages. One where the proteins were labeled with radioactive sulfur, so you can incorporate radioactive S into methionine and get that into viral proteins. Or they could label the DNA with radioactive phosphorus, because as you know, there's lots of phosphorus in a DNA molecule between each base. So then what they do is they add these phages to E. coli just long enough so that they would attach. So you could probably guess they want to do a synchronous infection. They do a high multiplicity infection. And then before very much happens, very early in infection, just long enough for the nucleic acid to get into the cell, they shear the phages off in the blender. So they just put the mixture in a blender and turn it on, and that shears all the phages off the surface. And then they ask, where does the label go and where is the label in new phages? So when you do that, if you use protein-labeled phages, the radioactivity is never inside of the cell. It's always in the supernatant. So when you shear off the phages, all the radioactivity go with them. And if you let the infection go longer, if you don't simply analyze the radioactivity, but let the bacteria incubate and let the phages undergo a replicative cycle so new phages are made, none of the new phages have the radioactive protein. So their interpretation was the protein goes away. And if you do the same experiment with the DNA-labeled phage, you shear off the virus after a brief incubation, you find that the radioactivity goes with the bacteria because you can separate them from the supernatant. And then if you let the infectious cycle continue, the radioactivity gets into new phages. So this DNA is replicated, and so the new viral DNA has some radioactivity in it as well. So this established that the DNA was the genetic material of these phages, and as I said, the experiments with tobacco mosaic showed that RNA could also be the genetic material. Now Hershey was very lucky, and science is full of this. You have to be lucky, there's a lot of serendipity involved. He used a phage where the protein doesn't get into the cell. We now know there are phages where the protein gets in the cell with the nucleic acid. So can you imagine if he had used that kind of a phage for these experiments, he would have been totally confused because both the protein and the nucleic acid would have gotten into the cells. But he picked the right phage, and in the end, he ended up getting a Nobel Prize for this work. Very simple work with a kitchen blender. Okay, so there are now, we know, seven different kinds of viral genomes, the number seven. You got to remember that. It's easy, the number seven train, your favorite athlete with number seven. However you do it, there are seven different kinds of viral genomes. And that's nice because I've already told you how many billions and billions of viruses are out there. But it turns out that all of their genomes come in seven different kinds. Okay, and you're going to learn all those seven kinds. It's really easy because it's probably all the seven ways that you can think of putting nucleic acids together. And how we're going to organize this is around this fact, which is that all viruses have to produce mRNA that can be translated by the translation system of the host, because no virus encodes a translation system. Just remember that, which means that they have to make mRNA that a cell will recognize. They can't make anything different or virus-specific. So cellular mRNAs are translated by the translation system, and that has to be exactly the same for viruses. Every virus that we know of does this. Now, it could be that we'll find a virus one day that encodes a translation system, but we haven't done that yet. So right now, remember, all viruses have to make mRNA. And this, by the way, is a ribosome. It turns out it looks like a turkey, which was pointed out to us a long time ago. So we call them flying turkeys. You'll see them in some of the pictures. So we took these, or we didn't, but David Baltimore, who has shown up here, he's a Nobel laureate who discovered reverse transcriptase, and we will talk about his work a bit later. He likes to fish also. He, in the 1970s, organized these viral genomes in a way that makes a lot of sense. And this is called the Baltimore scheme, and it's shown here. He had, at the time, six different viral genome types. We had not yet discovered the hepatitis B virus and its genome, which is shown here. That's number seven. So we've added that to the scheme. And what Baltimore did is put mRNA in the middle. And he said, let's see the seven different, or the six for him, seven for us, different genome types and how they get to mRNA. So that's the Baltimore scheme. You put mRNA in the middle, and then you start with, say, double-stranded DNA viruses. And from them, you can directly make mRNA. And some viruses actually are single-stranded DNA. And they have to be made double-stranded before they can be copied into mRNA, because mRNA can only be made from double-stranded DNA templates for DNA, all right? And that's another thing you have to remember. mRNA can only be made from double-stranded DNA. So if you have a single-stranded DNA virus, the first thing that has to happen when it comes in the cell, its genome has to be made double-stranded, and then it can be made into mRNA. There's some viruses with a gapped DNA genome. These are the hepatitis B viruses. The DNA is not fully double-stranded. It has pieces missing. That cannot be copied into mRNA. It has to be repaired first to double-stranded DNA and then made into mRNA. Now, then we have RNA viruses. We have double-stranded RNA viruses. And there are a couple of rules you can remember here. First of all, ribosomes can't translate double-stranded RNA. It has to be single-stranded. So somehow these viruses have to make mRNA from this double-stranded molecule. And the way they do it is to copy the negative strand template. Now, in our convention here, we color the two strands of DNA and RNA different colors. So the plus strand is a darker blue, and the minus strand is a lighter blue. Plus strand of mRNA is this Kellyish green, and then the minus strand is the brownish color. We have viruses with just negative strand RNA. They have to be copied to be made into mRNA because they can't be translated. And then we have plus-stranded RNAs that go through a DNA intermediate. We will talk about these in much more detail in a few minutes. And then we have plus-stranded viruses whose RNA can be directly translated. But to make more genomes, they have to go through a minus-strand intermediate. Okay, so this is the Baltimore scheme. It's really brilliant because it allows you to figure out, if I just threw out at you double-stranded RNA virus, you could tell me exactly what has to happen when that RNA gets into a cell if you just think mRNA is the goal. That's what we have to reach. So I've used a couple of definitions which you might not be familiar with. So let's go over those and make sure you understand what I'm talking about. Yes?
I just have a quick question about number four. Shouldn't the arrow after the negative strand of RNA lead to DNA first and then to mRNA?
You're talking about this one, number four. So these are plus strand RNA viruses that do not have a DNA intermediate.
So they're just translated right off the...
They're translated immediately, yes. So they're not all plus strand RNA viruses need to go through a DNA.
You mentioned that if they were to undergo replication, they would have to go through DNA.
No, they have to go through RNA.
Oh, RNA.
Yes, so that's what this is. Plus RNA to minus RNA to make more plus RNA.
Oh.
That's the replication step, right? Okay, so mRNA is always the plus strand. So this is just a convention. It doesn't mean anything. They could have said it's the minus strand years ago. It has nothing to do with polarity or electricity or anything like that. It's just years ago someone said mRNA is the plus strand. So that's what we're stuck with. DNA of the equivalent polarity is also the plus strand. So in a double-stranded DNA, one strand is plus and minus. The other is minus. The plus strand is the equivalent of mRNA. The minus strand is the complement. So RNA and DNA complements of plus strands or negative strands. So in a DNA, the minus strand is copied to make mRNA because the minus strand is the template for mRNA. But the plus strand would be the equivalent of mRNA. But of course, it is not translated in DNA because we don't translate DNA. So mRNA is ribosome ready. It's ready to be translated. But we do distinguish between plus RNA and mRNA for some viruses. So if you see a virus with a plus strand RNA genome, most of the time it can be directly translated, but there are a few exceptions. I would like it to be a general rule, but it's not, and we'll see what those exceptions are again. All right, so those are the polarity definitions that we use in this Baltimore scheme. So again, the Baltimore scheme is really elegant because if I give you a genome configuration, and there are only seven, I can give you any one of those, and you can, if you think of the Baltimore scheme, put mRNA in the middle, and remember a few rules, like only double-stranded DNA can be made into mRNA, double-stranded RNA can't be translated. Remember a few rules. You'll be able to sort out all of these pathways. So this is a great scheme for figuring out how viruses replicate. So those are the seven classes of viral genomes. We've gone over them, but let's go through again. So there are a couple, three with DNA, three different classes of virus with DNA. It's easy, double-stranded DNA, single-stranded. Those are the two that you could get right off the bat. And then there's the gapped DNA, which you just have to remember that some of the double-stranded DNAs are gapped. And the same with RNA. We have a double-stranded RNA, then we have single-stranded RNAs. In this case, they can be plus or minus strand. So what that means is in the virion, you can either have a plus RNA or a minus RNA. And it has, that has implications for the replication strategy, and we'll talk about that in some detail. And then there's a separate class of single-stranded positive sense RNA viruses with a DNA intermediate. So they have plus-stranded RNA in the virus particle, but that plus-stranded RNA isn't immediately translated as it is for these single-stranded plus-stranded RNA viruses. It is first copied into DNA, and how that works we'll look at today. Yes?
Is there a reason you don't have a minus DNA virus? Is that just not discovered?
So it turns out that some of these single-stranded DNA viruses package either plus or minus strands. So we could, we don't make it a separate class because these are the same virus that simply puts either strand in the particle. And that works because they have to simply be made double-stranded when they get into cells. So any single-stranded DNA virus has to be, it's actually repaired by the cellular DNA repair pathway. So we don't consider it a separate class. It doesn't have any functional implications as if you compare plus RNA to minus RNA, okay? All right, let's do a question here. Go to Socrative and the room number, of course, is virus. Okay, most people got number four because all viral genomes must make mRNA, and that's correct. And one and two, one is because all virus particles contain mRNA. That's not right, as you know, they don't all. Some of them are DNA viruses. There's no specific reason. There's always a reason. Number three is because all viral genomes are mRNAs. Now, some of the genomes are DNAs, right? And some of them are negative strand mRNA, so they're not all. And the last one was because Baltimore studied mRNA. No, he didn't. He actually discovered reverse transcriptase, so that's okay. All right, she mostly got that. So here, besides these seven classes, there are lots of different structural variants of viral genomes, and here what they look like. We've already talked about linear, circular, segmented, and gapped, single-stranded, plus and minus. Sometimes single-stranded can have both polarities, plus and minus. We call that ambisense. We'll talk about that a bit later. Double-stranded. And then some other modifications. You can have covalently attached proteins to some genomes. The ends can be cross-linked, or there can be covalently attached RNA. So these are just additional modifications. Again, we don't consider this beyond the seven genome class. None of this makes a new genome class. It's just things that can happen to viral genomes that make them different. And we'll discuss some of these, so you should be aware of them. So there's a lot of diversity beyond the seven in the way genomes are configured. And an interesting question is, does this mean anything? Can we deduce anything from it? Is one form more advantageous than another? And you may want to know if you have to memorize it, all right? So I always figured that a plus-strand RNA genome would make the most sense because the virus puts it in the cytoplasm and it could immediately be translated. But I didn't design the viral world, and in fact, they don't predominate. All different kinds of genome configuration are equally fit, apparently. So the only reason that we can say there are seven is because they all work. Yes? The question is the eclipse period of a plus strand RNA virus shorter? Yes, it is. So the longer eclipse periods occur for DNA viruses that have to get into the nucleus, be transcribed to an mRNA, and then the mRNA has to get back out. It can be 10, 12 hours for some viruses, yeah, so it can be significant. But yet, the DNA viruses still survive. They are evolutionarily fit, so we can't really say that there's any one advantage. Yes?
Do
the classes of genome affect the mutation rate? Only in the sense of DNA versus RNA viruses. So RNA viruses in general have a much higher mutation rate than DNA viruses. But there, even within the DNA viruses, there's some variability, and we'll talk about that in more detail. So I don't know what the advantage of a particular genome configuration is. Typically, you know, a DNA genome versus an RNA genome is packaged differently into the capsid, so it's a reflection of the whole replicative cycle. But in the end, I can't answer why all of these genomes exist and why one doesn't. What we can say, however, is why we have RNA and DNA-based genomes in the viral world. Because as you know, all other organisms on the planet have DNA-based genomes, but viruses have both. So the idea here is that in evolution, many, many billions of years ago, there was an RNA world where the first organisms, the first cells were RNA-based. The idea was that RNA evolved in solutions initially and then became cellular. And the idea is that the RNA viruses probably evolved in this RNA world. Then DNA emerged. Probably as one of the enzymes that copied the RNA mutated, so it started making a DNA copy. And then we had the DNA world, and that led to DNA cells. And so today we have, and then those DNA viruses emerged that could infect those DNA cells. And so the idea is that we no longer have an RNA world. All cells are DNA-based, but the RNA viral genomes remain. So the idea is they're a relic of the RNA world. But of course, we can't prove this because we have no way of looking back. The interesting question is when there was a switch, probably involves this enzyme reverse transcriptase, which copies RNA into DNA. We will talk about that later during our discussion of evolution. And as far as memorization goes, yes, you should memorize this, but this is really simple because you just start with mRNA in the middle. You should know the seven different genome types, which are pretty straightforward because I can't think of another kind of genome, frankly. An interesting question for thought is, what other genome configurations could you come up with? And I really can't think of any. Maybe maybe circular RNA, which, as far as I know, exists in some of these viruses, but we don't make that a separate genome type. So you should memorize the 7 genome types and then representatives of each one. So if I say influenza virus, you should know it's a minus strand RNA genome. So these viruses that are on this slide are some of the representatives that we'll be talking about throughout this course. We use a core set of viruses to discuss virology. So you should know at least one representative member of each of these virus families. And as we talk more about each one, you'll become familiar with them because we'll be repeating it over and over. So memorize those 7 genome types and the key virus families that were on that slide. Do it as soon as you can. Don't wait till the very day before the exam because it'll be harder for that. You should be able, if I tell you poliovirus, how does it get to mRNA? You should be able to tell me, well, the viral RNA is mRNA, so that's it. That's all, and for that plus-stranded mRNA class, that's all you have to do. So how you make mRNA, and then how the genome is copied to make more genomes. And that's all part of the Baltimore scheme. So for poliovirus, you start with a plus mRNA. That can either be directly translated. If you want to make more genomes, it has to go through a negative strand intermediate. So that's what you need to know there. So we're going to talk about each of these 7 classes a bit more in detail, but let me give you some overview of what is encoded in a virus genome and what is not, because viral genomes are limited for the most part in size, so they can't encode everything. So some of the things that they do encode, they encode proteins for the most part that manage the replication of the genome. So some viruses, all viruses encode at least one protein that's involved in genome replication, and some actually encode the enzymes, as you see. They have to encode proteins to assemble and package the genome, so these are typically structural proteins. Some viruses encode proteins that regulate the replication cycle. Remember the infectious cycle, the replication cycle that we talked about last time. This needs to be timed, and the viruses encode the proteins that do that. A very big area that's just been discovered in the past 10 years, all viruses, in fact, encode at least one protein that antagonized host defenses. Our immune system is so good that if viruses didn't encode antagonists, they wouldn't be around. And every viral genome encodes at least one. And when I was a student in the 70s, we didn't know any of these proteins. It's amazing how much we have learned since then, and we'll talk about some of those later. And finally, they encode proteins to help the virus spread from one cell to another, whether it be by breaking open the cells, the infected cells, or by allowing fusion of cells to cell. For example, by syncytia formation, which we talked about last time. Some of the things that are not encoded, as far as we know, right? We've only got virus genomes of a certain size. There are no genes encoding the complete protein synthesis machinery. And I qualify that with complete, and we'll see what that means in a moment. No genes involved in energy production or membrane biosynthesis. So viruses can't make ATP, they can't make a lipid bilayer, they depend on the cell. There are no centromeres or telomeres like the ones in host cells in viruses. And again, this is what we know today, and the situation changes. So for example, when I first started teaching this course, we didn't know about these giant DNA viruses. And some of these, and these are viruses with genomes at a million base pairs or greater. The biggest one we know of is 2.5 million base pairs, the Pandora virus. Some of these viruses encode components of the protein synthesis machinery. We didn't know that before 5 years ago. So I used to say, no virus encodes any part of the protein synthesis machinery. But now we know viruses that have a couple of tRNAs, that have a couple of tRNA synthetases, and a few other enzymes. Not the complete protein synthesis machinery. They don't code any ribosomal proteins and so forth, but they have some of it. So the possibility exists that someday we'll find a virus that has all of it. One of the ideas about how viruses emerged is that they started as cells, and they broke away from cells and took a lot of genes with them, and then they began to lose the genes one by one. So you could imagine that maybe there is still out there a virus that's very ancient and has a lot of the original genes, and maybe it has a complete protein synthesis translation machinery. Now, these viruses, these giant viruses, Mimi virus, Mega virus, Pandora virus, over 90% of their genes we don't even recognize. So we have this gene data bank that is stored on computers here and in other parts of the world. It's called GenBank. And whenever someone sequences something, they put the sequence there. And when you isolate a new organism, what you do is sequence its genome and immediately compare it against that database of known sequences. And most of the time you can say, this is a new picornavirus or a new coronavirus. But for these viruses, over 90% of the genes, these are viruses with thousands of genes, we have no idea what they are. They don't match anything. They don't have any motif that would say it's an enzyme of some kind or a membrane protein. They are just totally alien. And so it could be that they encode some part of a protein synthesis machinery that we don't recognize. So people need to work on this. Some people think that because these viruses have such unknown proteins, that they are actually derived from a fourth domain of life. All right, so now we have bacteria and eukaryotes and archaea. Those are the three main branches of life. But people think there was a fourth. And maybe it's either extinct and these viruses derived from it, or maybe it's somewhere on Earth and we haven't found it. So there are places we haven't looked, and there could be a fourth domain of life. So we'll see about that. It looks like most people picked number 5, enzymes to replicate the viral genome. And that is, of all the choices, the correct one. Membrane biosynthesis, no. Energy production, no. Complete protein synthesis systems, no. Parts of it, and no centromeres or telomeres. So that's good. You got that one. Now let's talk about some viral DNA genomes. Yeah, and our host genetic system, of course, is based on DNA. So these viruses, in large part, do very similar things to what our cells do. And we'll talk about those when we talk about DNA replication. But most viral genomes are not like cell chromosomes. You know, cell chromosomes are chromatinized. The DNA is wrapped around nucleosomes and all wound up, and this helps regulate transcriptional activity. Viral genomes, for the most part, there's one virus that looks like this. The DNA is actually wrapped up in nucleosomes, but all the other ones are not. So viruses have evolved other ways to regulate their gene expression that doesn't depend on histone acetylases, for example. And the let's start with double-stranded DNA viruses. These are viruses that infect mammals. And here's an icon of each one, so you can get to start to know relative sizes. These are more or less to scale with respect to each other. And the first is adenoviruses, which has this very unusual Sputnik-like appearance. Hepadenoviruses or hepatitis B viruses. These are agents of hepatitis, and they're very unusual because they have a gapped DNA genome. We put them in here with double-stranded, but they're actually a separate class. Herpes viruses, that's a herpes virus. Here, it's an envelope virus. That's interesting because it has an icosahedral capsid, and you'll see what that means next time, but it's enveloped. Papillomaviruses, you can see they're very similar to adenoviruses without these projections. They're smaller. Polyomaviruses, even smaller. And biggest here are the pox viruses. But in fact, the Mimi, Mega, and Pandoras are even bigger than pox virus, but it's not one of our core viruses that we use to study because we don't know enough about it. So this is the scheme. I've taken this from the Baltimore scheme and put it up at the top here so we can talk about it. The double-stranded DNA can be transcribed directly into mRNA by DNA-dependent RNA polymerases. So double-stranded DNA is fine for making mRNA. So when these viruses get into the cell, they need to go into the nucleus, except there's one exception we'll see, and they have mRNA made, which makes proteins. And then some of those proteins can replicate the DNA so that you can make new particles. There are two general classes of double-stranded DNA viruses. On the left, exemplified by the polyomaviruses and the papillomaviruses. These have circular double-stranded DNA genomes. They're rather small, 5 kilobase pairs, 8 kilobase pairs. And we'll talk a little bit about what these viruses do to you later in the course. These genomes aren't very big. They can't encode a lot of proteins. So they do not encode a host DNA polymerase. They don't encode an RNA polymerase. They use those enzymes from the host. These genomes on the right of adenovirus, herpes virus, and pox viruses are substantially larger. The adeno from 36 to 48 kilobase pairs. These are linear double-stranded DNA molecules. The same for the herpes virus genome, linear double-stranded DNA slightly larger, and the pox viruses are even bigger. Pox virus DNA genome is also linear double-stranded. The ends happen to be covalently joined. So you know at the end of double-stranded DNAs, there are 5' and 3' ends, 5' and 3'. And in the pox viruses, these are actually covalently linked. So there is a terminal loop at each end. If you denatured that double-stranded pox viral DNA, if you melted the strands, it would be a single-stranded circle. But as it exists in the virus, it's double-stranded. So all of these virus genomes are big, and they can encode DNA polymerase to replicate the genome. So they do not use the host DNA-dependent DNA polymerase to replicate their genomes. And then in addition, they encode enzymes to make their own mRNA. So those are the double-stranded DNA. All of these have to go to the nucleus, with the exception of pox viruses. Pox viruses encode everything they need except for a protein translation machinery, energy generation, et cetera. They encode everything they need to make their genomes and particles in the cytoplasm. So they encode a DNA polymerase, an RNA polymerase, and they can assemble virions in the cytoplasm. So they don't have to get in the nucleus. All these other viruses, their genomes, the first thing has to happen is to go in the nucleus because you have to make mRNA to get replication started. The gapped double-stranded DNA genomes, they're called hepadenoviruses or hepatitis B virus. In the virus particle is a double-stranded DNA genome with gaps. It also has a number of other weird modifications. So here's the genome expanded at the bottom here. You can see a very large gap here. That's the minus strand in light blue. The plus strand is in darker blue, so there's a big gap. There's also a piece of RNA attached to one end of the plus strand, and then there's a protein attached to the minus strand here, this blue circle. So it's very unusual. And this molecule, when it gets into cells, has to be repaired. The protein has to be taken off, the RNA has to be taken off, the gap has to be filled in to make double-stranded DNA, because that's the only thing that can be made into mRNA. All right, so the way to remember these patterns is to just remember the only in a DNA virus, the only substrate for mRNA synthesis is fully double-stranded DNA. No gaps, no proteins, no RNAs attached to them. Now this virus, so it gets repaired, its DNA in the nucleus, and then it is transcribed to form plus-stranded mRNA, which is translated into proteins. This virus is weird in its replication scheme. What happens is that some of these RNAs, instead of being translated, are actually copied into a single-stranded DNA molecule by the reverse transcriptase enzyme encoded in the virus genome. So that is first a negative-stranded DNA, and then that's made double-stranded. But it's not complete. It's got gaps, and it's got the protein, and it's got the RNA, and that's packaged into virions. And we will see how this arises a bit later when we talk about reverse transcription. Okay, but the point here maybe is the major point that this has got to be repaired, this genome, before it can get into cell and make mRNA. Again, single-stranded DNA genomes, they exist in the particle. They can be actually plus or minus, as I mentioned briefly before. We just classify them as plus-stranded DNA molecules. These have to be repaired to be made double-stranded before they can be transcribed into mRNA. So again, these viruses go in the nucleus. The DNA is repaired to a double-stranded form. It's transcribed to mRNA. Proteins are made, which can then participate in genome replication and eventually packaging of new virions. There are two kinds of genomes in these viruses. There are circular single-stranded DNA viruses, and one example of this is a family called circoviridae. They are the smallest known DNA virus genomes, 1.7 to 2.2 kilobases. They can encode one or two proteins, and that's amazing. These can get into cells and completely take over the cell. One example of this is a virus called TT virus. And I would say 90% of you have been infected with this virus. And apparently it doesn't do anything, at least nothing negative. Maybe it helps us, but we don't know. So it's a ubiquitous human virus. Then there are some viruses called parvoviruses. Their genomes are slightly bigger, 4 to 6 kilobases. And they are single-stranded, but the ends have terminal inverted complementarity, so they can form these unusual T structures. And those are involved in DNA replication, as we will see later. Parvoviruses can cause human diseases. The so-called fifth disease is a rash disease caused by parvovirus. And there are 4 other common childhood diseases before that caused by viruses. This is the fifth. And parvoviruses can infect your pets. Dogs and cats can have parvovirus infections. They can be lethal in your pets, so you have to have a vaccine to protect them against that. And also, parvoviruses are important vectors for gene therapy. We will have a lecture at the end of this course about how we can use viral genomes to introduce genes into people who lack them. And these are a very big player in that field. Double-stranded DNA, of course. That's the only thing, not gapped. Gap has to be repaired. That's the hepatinovirus genome. Circular single-stranded DNA cannot be made into mRNA. It has to be repaired to double strand. Linear single-stranded DNA cannot. It has to be double-stranded. And not all of the above, of course. Okay. Double-stranded DNA is the one that can be transcribed directly into mRNA. Okay, so that's DNA genomes. Let's turn to RNA. Now, here the thing you need to know is that cells don't have an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. They have all kinds of other polymerases. They have DNA-dependent DNA, DNA-dependent RNA, but they do not have an enzyme that can copy viral RNA to make more of it. So that means every RNA virus genome has to encode an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So that's my abbreviation, RDRP, RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And these polymerases produce mRNAs and genomes from viral RNA templates. So sometimes the mRNA is the genome, sometimes it's not. We'll see that in a moment. So they can make mRNAs and new virus genomes. They can make both. And the mRNAs they make have to be readable by host ribosomes, right? If they weren't, the virus wouldn't work because it has to use the cell translation system. So it has to have all the features of an mRNA that are needed for translation, and we'll talk about those later. All right, so those are RNA-dependent RNA polymerases. They're encoded in the genome of every RNA virus. So let's start with viruses with double-stranded RNA genomes. These are called reoviruses. Reoviridae is the family name. And these viruses actually don't have a single piece of nucleic acid in their virus particle. For these, they have 10. All right, so they're segments, we call them, RNA segments, and they're all put into the virus and all delivered at the same time. This double-stranded RNA cannot be translated. Even though it has a plus strand in it, and that's the green color there, the ribosome can't access it because it's hidden in the double strand. So that's intuitive. All right, now, in virology, you can't always go by your intuition, but in this case, it's intuitive to think that a double-stranded RNA, the plus strand wouldn't be accessible. So these double-stranded RNAs cannot simply come into a cell and be translated. And you may say, well, can't you denature the double-stranded RNA and expose the plus strand? You could, but that doesn't happen. All right? What has to happen is that the virus in the particle, in addition to these 10 double-stranded RNA segments, it brings in an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So it brings in its own enzyme in the particle. And as soon as it gets in the cell, that enzyme makes an mRNA from the minus strand in that double-stranded RNA. Yes?
So when the viral RNA is getting copied into mRNA, does it also undergo alternative splicing?
So the question is, when viral RNA is copied into mRNA, do you get alternative splicing? The answer is yes, for some viruses. It's not a rule for all viruses, but a couple of virus families do that. And we'll see that later. Yeah. Yes?
When you say RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, are you saying that RNA polymerase is specific only to, like, that it can work on.
Okay, so what does RNA-dependent RNA polymerase mean? Is it specific for the particular virus that you isolated from, or could an influenza RNA polymerase replicate a poliovirus RNA? As far as we know, they're specific for the virus. There are signals in the viral RNAs that only allow the polymerase of that virus to replicate the RNA. Okay. Did you have a question?
Yeah, so that the polymerase that the RNA genome encodes copies the strand of RNA while it's double-stranded. It doesn't separate at all.
So the question is, does the RNA polymerase copy this double-stranded RNA as a duplex, or is it separated? It has to separate it. So to access one strand, the polymerase has to separate it. And we don't know the details because we've never seen that happen. But the presumption is the polymerase, it has also a denaturing or melting activity associated with it. And as it moves down, it melts the strand, copies one, and then they rehybridize behind it. That's what would probably have to happen. Yeah?
And so what prevents the RDRP from denaturing the double-stranded RNA within the particle?
So it probably does transiently.
Okay.
So you have a double-stranded DNA. So the question was, what prevents the RDRP from denaturing the double-stranded RNA in the particles? So the idea is that the polymerase binds at one end of the duplex and makes a little bubble. And then as it gets past and synthesizes the plus strand, the strands come back together. So it's a transient melting, very much like happens in DNA, as we'll see. Okay. So these viruses get in, the polymerase in the particle makes mRNAs, and then those are translated to proteins, which then go on to replicate the genome and make more particles. So this is the first principle in an RNA virus, that some of them have to have a polymerase in the particle. And you'll be able to figure out which ones by just thinking about how the replication goes. So remember, all RNA viruses have to encode an RNA polymerase, no question. Some of them need to put it in the particle, and others don't. They can just encode it in the genome. So these viruses have to have it in the particle because the double-stranded RNAs can't be translated. It's all about whether you can translate when you first come in. So then there are a class of viruses with plus-sense RNA, single strands, and these are eight families that contain viruses that infect mammals. The bacornaviruses, which include polio and rhinovirus. The coliseviridae, this includes the noroviruses, the so-called cruise ship viruses that cause outbreaks of gastroenteritis. We'll talk about those later. Astroviruses, which also cause gastroenteritis. Coronavirus, SARS, MERS, and other various viruses. Artery viruses, flaviviruses, yellow fever virus, West Nile hepatitis C virus. The retroviruses, like HIV. And the togovirus, which include rubella and equine encephalitis virus. So let's take a look at some of these. So these are the viruses in this class that do not go through a DNA intermediate in their replication. So what's in the particle is a plus sense RNA. Corona, you can see here, these are the longest RNA virus genomes that we know about, 33 kb. Then we have the flavies like yellow fever, West Nile, they're slightly shorter. The bacornas and the toga. So there's the viral RNA plus stranded. These all have untranslated regions at the 5' prime and the 3' prime end. Many of them have a poly A sequence. Now, as you know, for efficient mRNA translation in a cell, the mRNA should have a poly A, and most of these do. But not all of them. You see the flavies do not. And so they get around that requirement in other ways. And also you need a 5' prime cap on the mRNA to get efficient translation, and you can see most of these viruses do, but the bacornas do not. They have a protein linked, and they get around not having a cap in other ways that we will talk about. So these viruses are plus-stranded. All the viruses in this class, when that plus-stranded genome gets into cytoplasm, it can be translated immediately. So that's the feature of this class of RNA. So there's the genome. It's an mRNA, can be translated right into protein. So that means the virus does not have to carry an RNA polymerase in the particle, right? You don't need to, because the genome can come in and be translated. Why put a polymerase in the particle? Genome is translated, you make proteins, and then the proteins go towards one of those proteins is the RNA polymerase, which can copy the genome. You take a plus strand, you make a minus strand, and then more plus strands, and then eventually you can assemble new virus particles. Okay, so these are plus-stranded genomes. The genome is mRNA, and they do not have to carry a polymerase in the particle, but they do have to encode one, right? Because this genome cannot replicate without an RNA polymerase. So the answer is one. Single-stranded, plus-stranded, single-stranded RNA genomes can be translated to make protein. So everybody gave, there were some people on each of the others, so let's go through that. Go back to the question here. Double-stranded DNA genomes can be translated. They can't. They have to have an mRNA made from the double strand because the double-stranded, the ribosome can't access it. So that doesn't work. Single-stranded, plus-stranded, single-stranded RNA virus replication cycles do not require a minus single-strand intermediate. They do. To replicate, they have to go through a minus strand. RNA genomes can be copied by host cell polymerases. That's wrong. That's one thing I was trying to emphasize, and of course it's none of the above. So let's see what the distribution was again. Yeah, so that last one, all of the above, a lot of people did that. So it's number one, of course. Okay. I understand that sometimes difficult to pick it up and then answer right away, but this tells you what I think is important from what I'm telling you. Okay, plus-stranded RNA viruses, single strand, but now these have a DNA intermediate. Okay, and there's one family that we know about like this. They're called retroviridae, retroviruses. And they're two human pathogens, HIV, HIV 1 and 2, and human T lymphotropic virus, HTLV. And there are lots of other retroviruses, but they don't infect people. They infect other kinds of animals. And these are fascinating viruses. We'll talk quite a bit about these in this course. So their genome is plus-stranded RNA. So this is a tough one, because if you just look at it without knowing anything about the life cycle, you would say, aha, this plus-strand RNA gets to the cytoplasm and it's translated, right? So this is the exception where not all plus-strand RNAs are mRNAs, because this virus, even if you took the RNA out of the virion, you could translate it. But when the virus infects the cell, that's not what happens. When this virus comes into a cell, the RNA is copied into a negative strand DNA. And that is done by reverse transcriptase, which is in the virus particle. So within that virus, you can see RNA genomes, and there's some other dots in there, and one of those is the reverse transcriptase. Because even though cells do actually have reverse transcriptase activity, there's not much of it, and it probably wouldn't work for this virus. So the virus brings in its own reverse transcriptase, makes a negative strand DNA, and then it makes it double-stranded. Because to make mRNA, you have to make it double-stranded. And then, from that, mRNA is made. Okay, the mRNA can be translated into protein. And then, to make more genomes, some of those mRNAs are simply packaged. So once those mRNAs are made, they can be packaged into virions. Now, the interesting thing about the mRNAs that are produced here, these are made by the host cell DNA-dependent RNA polymerase. So what happens when the virus makes this double-stranded DNA copy, this is in the nucleus, this integrates into chromosomal DNA. It becomes a permanent part of the cell, and then we call it a provirus. That's the specific name for it. And then to the cell, it looks like any other gene, and the cell copies it. So the cell DNA-dependent RNA polymerase makes these retroviral RNAs from the proviral DNA that is integrated. Is there a question up there? Yeah.
Yeah, so on one of the previous slides, you mentioned that RNA viruses require RNA-dependent RNA polymerases. But on this, I'm assuming that for the retrovirus, that's not required.
Right, it requires a RNA-dependent DNA polymerase. So basically, they all require a enzyme that can recognize an RNA template. And the product can either be RNA or DNA. Okay.
Right.
So the provirus is an integrated form. These viruses make this. They have an enzyme that integrates the DNA into the host cell. We'll talk about that later on. And then sitting in the chromosomal DNA, the mRNAs are made, which can then catalyze the replication cycle. So really quite unique. The last class are negative sense single-stranded RNA viruses. These are the mammalian viruses. There are some very famous viruses in here. Measles virus, mumps, or paramyxoviruses. rhabdovirus, rabies virus, Borna viruses, the filovirus, the Ebola and Marburg virus, influenza virus here, orthomyxoviruses, and arena virus, Lassa virus. And I have to say that arena viruses are probably what got me into virology. This was one of the first emerging virus infections discovered in the 1960s in Nigeria. And there's a book written about it here called Fever. And I read it after I graduated from college. I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my life. You know, I graduated from college and I said, now what? So I went to work in a lab and I read this book and I said, I have to work on viruses. So that's why I show this here, because I am here talking to you because of this book. It's really good. A lot of it takes place at Columbia Medical Center. So these viruses, negative strand, so you can tell me right away that they can't be translated by definition, right? So the RNA gets into the cell, it can't be translated, so these viruses must carry a polymerase in the particle to make a plus strand mRNA from that negative strand. So the viruses in the particle, all of these negative strand viruses carry an enzyme in the particle, an RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, and that copies the incoming negative strand RNAs into mRNAs. They're translated into proteins, and then some of those proteins participate in the replication of the genome from minus to plus to minus. So there are lots of viruses that do this. Influenza is quite a big one. These viruses, their genomes can be in pieces like the rhinoviruses. Remember the double-stranded RNA viruses in 10 pieces. The influenza viruses have 6 to 8 separate RNA pieces. They're all negative stranded. They're all packed in the virus particle. You need all of them for replication. So we call this a segmented genome. And then there are viruses of negative polarity, which are non-segmented. And all that means is that the genome is one molecule of RNA. The paramyxoviruses and the rhabdoviruses are shown here. So the correct answer is number 3. They can replicate RNA virus genomes. So let's look at, so if someone answered for all the others, the biggest are 2 and 5. So let's see what the issue was there. So number 1, they are found in uninfected cells. So RNA-dependent RNA polymerase are not found in uninfected cells. That's why RNA viruses have to encode them. They are not present in all RNA virus particles, only the ones with negative stranded genomes. The plus stranded RNA viruses don't need a polymerase in the particle because that plus strand can be directly translated. Number 3 is correct. They are not involved in the replication of DNA viruses. RNA-dependent RNA viruses are not. DNA-dependent RNA viruses are involved in transcription of DNA viruses. And they cannot replicate double-stranded DNA virus genomes is not correct. They can. Now, when the RNA genome is in pieces, as happens with the rhinoviruses and the influenza viruses, an interesting event can happen called reassortment. And if you have 2 viruses infecting a single cell, which can happen, if you're infected with enough virus particles, you can have multiply infected cells. And so let's say these 2 viruses have different genetic makeups. They have 8 segments. This is influenza virus, but they're slightly different. The RNAs replicate in the cell, and then the viruses that are produced can be a mixture of 8 RNAs from both parents. So we call those reassortants. So you can see here, the parental viruses have red and blue genomes, and the products are red and blue virus genomes, but some of them can reassort. So this virus, which is a reassortant, has the second segment from this L parent. So this happens often during infection with influenza, with rhinoviruses, and as you will see, it makes a big contribution to the way these viruses are able to evade our immune responses. Now, some negative sense RNA viruses are ambisense. They have both plus and minus strand character in their genome. And these are members of the rhinoviruses, one of my favorite, and bunyaviruses. So what does that mean? It means exactly as it sounds, the single-stranded RNAs that are in the particle. And these viruses typically have 2, a large and a small RNA. They have both plus and minus strand characters. So part of the RNA is a message and could be translated, and part of it is the antisense. It's a negative sense. It cannot be translated. We call these negative sense viruses nonetheless because they have to have a polymerase in the virion. Because even though this green protein Z can be translated when this RNA gets in the cell. This doesn't do the virus any good. It's not a polymerase. So the virus could not replicate if only this Z and this glycoprotein mRNA were translated. So in fact, what happens when you get into cells, the virion polymerase copies this segment to make an mRNA for the L protein. And the L protein is the RNA polymerase of the virus. Okay, so the polymerase is needed in the virion so that you can access this L gene. So it makes a subgenomic mRNA for the L and also for the NP. So part of the genome can be translated, but it's not enough to kickstart replication. So if this L protein were in the plus sense, then it would need to bring a polymerase into the cell. But because it's not, the virus has to bring the polymerase in to get more L made to replicate the genome. Right, so it's a nice mixture of plus and minus character and whether you need a polymerase in the virion or not. So think about that and it'll be clear. So at the end now, I want to talk a little bit about genetic methods. We've talked about the genomes. I want to tell you what you can do with viral genomes because we have amazing power now in virology, but we have to make sure we're on the same page in terms of genetic methods. I'm going to use the term wild type a lot. All this means is an original virus from which you make mutants. It can be laboratory adapted. All it is is a standard virus, and it doesn't even need to be something that's identical to whatever is in nature. When we isolate viruses from people or other animals, we call these field isolates or clinical isolates. And you may take one of these and establish it as your wild-type virus, but that's not a requirement to be a wild-type virus. We use methods called DNA-mediated transformation to introduce DNAs into cells. So DNA-mediated transformation is simply the introduction of foreign DNA into cells. It was given this very long name because there is another process called transformation, oncogenic transformation, which is a change in the character of a cell, and we will talk about that later. And so when DNA transformation was developed, they decided to distinguish it for that reason. Now, the first demonstration of DNA inserting DNA into cells and showing that it did something came in 1944. This very famous paper by Avery, McLeod, and McCarty. They showed that if you take a DNA out of a bacteria and put it in another bacteria, you can change the character of that bacteria. And in this experiment, they transformed the morphology of a bacterium by putting DNA into it. This is actually the first demonstration that DNA is a genetic material. You probably learned about this in biology. Even in high school, I think it's taught. So they called this transformation, putting DNA into cells, because it transformed the bacteria. So that name has stuck, DNA-mediated transformation. And nowadays, we do it with viral DNAs as well. When we use a viral DNA and put that into cells, it's called transfection. Because we're trying to make infectious virus, we're doing a combination of transformation and infection. It was first shown by Lambda. They took Lambda phages, they extracted the DNA, they introduced that into cells by DNA-mediated transformation, and viruses came out. So that's transfection. Unfortunately, nowadays, people use transfection to mean the introduction of anything into any kind of DNA into cells. So it's easier to say transfection than DNA-mediated transformation, right? So people say transfection. But what I mean when I say transfection is putting a viral DNA into cells with the purpose of starting a viral replication cycle. So I just want you to be clear on that. I will not use it the other way. Genetic methods, we talk about a lot in this course. They involve mutations of different sorts, changes in DNA or RNA. And there are all kinds of mutations that are made. The key point here is that mutation is an act on nucleic acid. You don't mutate a protein. You change the amino acid or you substitute the amino acid. You mutate the DNA or the RNA. So again, that's how I use the terminology. The plaque assay allowed us to do genetics with animal viruses because we could then pick individual clones of viruses that were genetically pure, at least we thought so, and work with them. If we didn't have this technique, it would have been very hard to do genetics. We talked about that last time. Now, in the old days, yes?
For transfection, is it only DNA or also RNA?
You could take RNA from the appropriate virus and introduce it into cells, and it would be transfection. So the question was, is transfection only DNA? No, it can be RNA or DNA. In the old days, we didn't make mutants. We isolated them. So RNA viruses are error-prone. Their polymerases make mistakes, and they don't correct them. There's a high error rate. DNA viruses also make mistakes, their polymerases, but they're corrected. There are proofreading enzymes that reduce the error rate. So you could just take any stock of an RNA virus. It would be full of mutants, and it was just a matter of applying the right selection, like plaque size or drug resistance, and then you could isolate the right mutant. Now, DNA viruses, because they have a lower mutation rate, were harder to isolate mutants with, so we used chemicals to treat the genome and mutagenize it, and that worked as well. But we don't do this any longer, okay, because now we have the infectious DNA clones. We have DNA copies of every viral genome, and we can alter those at will. There are many ways to change bases in DNA, to substitute genes using recombinant DNA technology. So we use what we call the infectious DNA clone to make viral mutants. And this is actually a validation of the Hershey-Chase experiment, because we make a DNA copy of the virus genome, and we put just that into cells, and we get virus out. So it shows that the DNA is the genetic material of the virus. And we can use that to make all kinds of changes in the viral genome. And we will talk about a lot of these in this course. Here's an example of doing this. Poliovirus, of course, when you infect cells, is infectious. It makes more virus. If you extract the RNA and transfect that into cells, you will also get virus, because the RNA can be translated and it initiates an infectious cycle. If you did this with influenza virus, which is a negative strand virus, if you put influenza virus RNA into cells, nothing would happen, because the cell can't translate it and there's no RNA polymerase in the cell. If you make a DNA copy of the poliovirus genome and put it into a plasmid, you can then introduce this DNA into cells and they will make infectious virus, or you could transcribe the DNA in vitro and make an RNA that looks like poliovirus and transfect that into cells as well. So again, this is an infectious DNA copy of the viral genome. It's cloned in a bacterial plasmid, so you can make lots of it. And it allows you to manipulate the virus. This can be done with every virus type that we talked about today. Every one of those seven virus classes now has an infectious clone. This is an example of how it was done for influenza virus. So influenza viruses have negative strand RNAs in their genomes. So what is done is to make a plasmid for each of the eight negative strands, where you've cloned the viral RNA sequences here as DNA. And then this plasmid, each of the eight plasmids, has two promoters, a Pol-2 promoter that will make mRNA and a Pol-1 promoter that will make the other strand a negative strand. So you have eight of these for each of the eight segments. You put them in cells, and out comes influenza virus. So you can make any influenza virus that you want. So let me give you a great example of how this was used. So back in 1918, there was a huge pandemic of influenza. Over 100 million people died globally. It was called Spanish flu. We didn't have influenza virus in 1918. We didn't isolate it until 1933. However, lots of people died from flu. A lot of them were in the army. This is World War I. And a lot of those army recruits had sections of their lungs taken and preserved. Their section, they're embedded in paraffin and formaldehyde fixed section. They're stored in some place in Washington. So 10 years ago, a few virologists went and got some of those slides and extracted the RNA and determined its sequence. And they pieced together the sequence of the 1918 influenza virus. They also went up to Alaska, where some flu victims had been buried, and they had been frozen ever since 1918. They opened up the grave. They took biopsies of the lungs. They extracted RNA. They sequenced it. So they completed all eight segments of the flu virus genome this way. And now we have this virus back, and people can work on it. Now, you have to work on it under the highest biological containment, because if it got out, it would probably kill a lot of people. It's quite lethal. But this is an example of how you can recover viruses that we never had in the first place and study them. We've learned a lot from doing this. But as you can imagine, there was a lot of concern about bioterrorism and releasing the sequence. And there's a big discussion about that. And we will return to that in our last lecture of this course when we talk about H5N1. So these infectious clones are great. You can make viruses you didn't have. You can make mutants. You can also do gene therapy with them. You can put genes in that people lack and deliver genes therapeutically. We'll talk about that at the end of the course as well.